I have a question from last time. So if there's a conventional reality, there must be another reality as well.
Paramatma is ultimate.
There's an ultimate reality?
Yes, you can't say anything about it.
You have to find it.
By its very nature, it's beyond saying anything. Because what everyone says is relative. One uses words, and words are always relative to things. The words are symbols. And we can talk about things like boxes and concrete and things like that, because we can talk to the objects like this. And there's always a relationship of ourselves to that. When you get to Paramatma, there's no relativity. There's nothing you can point to. I mean, in law, you must tell the truth and the whole truth and nothing but the truth, you know. That's the idea. But when you come down to what these conventions are and what is the basis of these conventions, all you can say is it's the acceptance of these. And that's really all it comes to.
Mm.
It even comes down to sensation. We see things, and we define things in our seeing, doing this or that. So when we come down to why do we define these things and make a distinction between them, it's really conventional. It's just practical, of course. These are all conventions that we've been brought up to, and they've gone in so deep that they're just in part of the world, natural. And when we talk about a tree, what do we talk about? Every tree is different. All we can say is there are certain characteristics to occur with trees.
Mm.
And this is conventional reality.
Is the Buddha sometimes talking about this and about the conventional reality and absolute?
Well, the thing is, he talked about conventional reality and he taught in terms of conventional reality.
Mm.
Because you can't talk about absolute reality. Because of that, you can say that what the Buddha taught, none of what the Buddha taught is absolutely true.
Mm.
Because you can't teach absolute truth. No way. Reality, convention and reality are very important. And we are riddled with convention. One of the very important points of convention is symbols. It's full of symbols and so on. They symbolize everything. It seems to be a trick of the mind that we can't handle too much information. Because of that, we group things into one symbol, we say it's that.
Mm.
I mean, that's take the code. You look at that, you can't handle what it is altogether. It's very complex. So we group it into one thing called take the code, and that's simple. And we handle that as an object. Yeah? And we're constantly grouping things and making them into symbols.
Mm.
And then, I mean, you get things like political parties. It's the most complex thing. Well, not only political, I mean other sorts of organizations. And we've got a name for them. And then we identify the name with either something good or something bad.
Mm.
And it disguises the complexity of the thing.
Mm.
And also it makes things untrue. Because when we talk about it as being good or bad, we're taking everything in that to us as either good or bad. And it's false. It's not happening. Because that convention is a very convenient thing to have, but it can also disguise the truth. It can prevent us seeing the truth of the matter. Again, I mean, if we talk about a person, something very complex. But we sort of say, oh, I don't like him, or I don't like that type, or something, that's what. But we're talking about something there that's changing the whole time, very complicated. And it's very easy to get quite wrong ideas in that way. When you look at the five khandhas, that's what we call a person. And that divides it down to five. But each of those five is very complicated. And it's not, each of the five is not even static. They're all changing the whole time. So you've got an enormously complex changing, almost like a vortex or something, whirling around all the time. And then we identify that as an individual. And we always think of it just as one person, just one like that. And we should really try to realize how complex these things are.
So is the citta that's different? It's not the panta, it's not the five panta.
The citta.
Really?
The original citta. But the citta are called Vedanasana Yasana Kama Nama. Those are citta, aspects of citta. I always like to look on them as being like the waves on the ocean. The original citta, the real citta, is like the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas these five, Vedanasana Sankara Vijnana, just like waves on the surface.
Mm-hmm.
They're not separate from it, but they're not the same thing either.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the only new non-duality that comes is when a citta goes down there and it's just knowing.
Mm-hmm.
They come apart, which is the just one. Because there's no object known. Mm. But there's just a state of knowing there. Mm. But that has to be clear.
This place of knowing, or just knowing.
Yes.
Is it different from just samadhi? Or is it...
In samadhi, there are thousands and one different experiences.
Uh-huh.
It's full of all sorts of odd things. Sometimes a person feels that they're 100 feet tall.
Uh-huh.
Very solid, made of rock.
Leaning over.
Possibly leaning over, yes.
Yeah.
At other times, at times, they can feel as though they're sort of thick and vast.
Mm.
Like that. These are just experiences.
But then, what is then, how could one describe then samadhi? Is it just normally
samadhi.
Concentration?
Samadhi is a state of mind. There are certain factors of mind which make up samadhi. One is it's a state of where the mind is absorbed.
Mm.
Comes and is absorbed in the object, and all the factors of mind come together.
Mm.
They talk about it as... Romkan, which really means integrated.
Mm.
Mind becomes integrated together like that. And when it's like that, it becomes very strong. And all sorts of odd experiences can come up.
Mm.
Also in samadhi, there's three distinct levels. There's the kanika level, which is momentary.
Mm.
You just get the taste of it for a short while, just a few quarter of a minute, a few seconds maybe. And it just disappears like that. That's kanika samadhi. Second is upachara samadhi. Upachara samadhi is where all sorts of things can happen. You see nimittas, what a nimitta is, image. You see nimittas, you maybe hear sounds, psychic things can happen, you may know the future, things at a distance. It's all sorts of things can happen there. But also frightening things can come up.
Mm.
And this is an area which a person should be careful of.
Mm.
Then there's the apana level, and that's the one that one should try and attain to get to. The apana level, the level where the chitta drops to the heart, and it's just one there. Body disappears, breathing stops, whole lot goes, and it's just that one there. And that is a state of complete happiness, complete contentment.
So then there's no object in there anymore, or?
No object.
Mm-hmm.
Just the one. But again, this has to experience.
Mm-hmm.
One can't really sort of reason about it. One can say really that if you could hold the mind from thinking about all sorts of things and wandering about, just hold it still.
Mm-hmm.
For long enough, it would automatically drop into the first stage of samadhi. Quite automatically. It's because the kilesas are afraid of it, But it, immediately it starts going in that direction, jumps up, oh, I don't know what's happening, you know, there's no, and it gets all broken up. Kilesas the whole time that are disturbing, they're disturbing the mind, and not allowing it to settle down there. It's like those waves, again, it's the wind that blows the waves up. And the winds of change, and the kilesas, you can say, they produce the waves there. If the wind stops, the waves calm down, and then it just goes out of the ocean. As they say, like a muddy pond of water, if it remains still long enough, the mud will settle to the bottom. It becomes clear. And the reason why one should get to this state is two reasons. First of all, to have a refuge. One knows, if one can get to that state, that in that state nothing can go wrong. No completion in that state. Secondly, when you're doing a lot of work on wisdom, if one gets tired, one can go back into that state. In fact, you can use it for rest any time you want. This is the main use of it. Also, when you go into that state and you come out, at least partially, then you can use wisdom very well too. Because that state, there's always a strong aftertaste to it. There's a state of calm now, a state where the mind is completely wielding, no longer stubborn or difficult. And you can then turn it to doing work, investigating the body. And then it's seen with wisdom easier. No difficulty. Wisdom just penetrates, so yes. It's not like normally where one has to think intellectually and sort of reason about it, and the mind sort of doesn't want to do it, and the places come up all the time suggesting other things. It's free from all that. Very valuable state, a person who can get there, but it's not easy. There's plenty of barriers there.
So it sounds like if you once got there, that it's easier to get there again.
The Tanachan gave his experience, where he started off, he wanted to learn how to do samadhi. So he asked his Upacharya, his teacher, the and he said, do Buddho, keep Buddho here. So he did this, and he did it for quite a while, and then he dropped into samadhi. And when he came out, he knew that was right, and then he said, oh, I want to do that now. After he couldn't do it. He tried, he couldn't do it, until he got really angry. He couldn't do it. And he said, it was a year. And then he decided, I'm just going to go on doing Buddha regardless of whether I get there or not. So he did that, and again he got there. And he realized what the result was. He was thinking all the time of the result, instead of doing the cause, making the cause to get that result. And because of that, you can see it's not always too easy. Having got there, the chalasa was stirred up, and there. Only too ready to say, all right, you're getting there, you're getting there.
Yeah. It's very subtle sometimes. You don't think you're thinking about it, but...
Samadhi is very valuable, there's no doubt about it. Very valuable. Yeah. One can get there. It's not easy.
With my understanding goes, jhana is also samadhi, but that there are different jhanas.
The different jhanas are different levels. Really, you can say the first four jhanas are where the state of the jhana is getting more and more subtle. The last four jhanas, where the objects are becoming more and more subtle. But the difference between jhana and samadhi, I don't know enough about it. I don't like talking very much about it. Tanachana also doesn't really like talking much about jhana. He says that it's one of the subjects which you can only really talk about with somebody who's actually experienced it and who knows it. generally sometimes if somebody asks him a question on Dhamma, he just quotes from the present book. And I'm not sure that it's very helpful. In the biography of Ajaan Mun, it says how he developed samadhi to begin with. And then he came to a point where he was getting limited, coming up all the time. Mostly sort of scenery and bits of this and bits of that coming up all the time. He did this for about 3 months, apparently. And he then sort of reviewed it and he thought, well, doing this all the time, I don't see that I've got any gain from it. So he then decided, from that moment on, he turned. He said, I'm going to do body concentration. And he turned to doing the body, contemplating the body. And, because to develop samadhi up to the point where one can hold, get the mind well concentrated and keep the kilesas at bay, that's valuable. To go much further than that is get less and less done. The thing that's necessary is to use the samadhi, use the what one has got in the samadhi to develop wisdom. Wisdom is the thing that matters all the time. In fact, anybody who has the capacity to really keep their mind on what they're doing, if they can develop the wisdom, that's the way to do it, it's straight away. Not many people can. It's usually advisable to have in samadhi experience as well. Can be valuable later on if one gets exhausted in the investigation. Also, if one has samadhi, there are things which normally would be unacceptable in wisdom. Because the kilesas are too much against that idea. With samadhi, because the kilesas are pacified, they're sort of laid at rest, that objection, that block isn't there. Samadhi can help one to help to make it much easier for the family.
I would think just having a place that's very happy to, that you go to would help a lot. You know, when you're thinking of giving up all these pleasures.
that's important too, because I mean samadhi is very pleasant. And that can help to make it much easier. Main thing is really we've got plenty of kilesas and our task is to use whatever method we can to get rid of them. As Tanachan says, we have to scramble up. It's not always an orderly thing. One develops samadhi and one develops wisdom. But it isn't always that the samadhi comes nice and neatly and comes first and then the wisdom comes like this. It doesn't work always like that. You have to develop whatever's available at the time. Whatever the problems are, have to deal with it. Whatever's available.
One question which always puzzles me is how much samadhi I develop before I develop the wisdom? Or, you know, how many years am I trying to get samadhi to find out maybe I can't get it?
That's not the way.
Yeah.
You've got to develop sila, samadhi and wisdom and panya. All three. The whole time.
Okay.
But the thing is that the samadhi is the one to concentrate on, to begin with. It only says you shouldn't use any wisdom.
No.
Definitely. And it's a good practice that when you do a period of practicing samadhi, when you come out of that, you feel you've done enough. When you come out, turn and do a bit of investigation. Develop the wisdom. Investigating the body. Okay. Because if you do that as training, then you don't fall into the trap of getting addicted to samadhi. Because But when samadhi comes, if one gets into samadhi, and one gets learns how to get there easily, it's very pleasant. Because that one wants to do samadhi the whole time. One's much more interested in developing wisdom because that's hard work. It's like how it's so difficult to get up in the morning when it's cold. One doesn't want to. One much prefers to sort of go to sleep there. It's like that with samadhi. So if one develops the habit of developing of doing some practice on wisdom after the samadhi, then this can become an ingrained habit. When one stops, when one finishes the samadhi practice, then one develops some wisdom. And there isn't the tendency to get caught in the pleasantness of samadhi. The thing is, when one develops samadhi, one needs the parikamba, and the main attention one should put on is the attention to be mindful. And it's that mindfulness you want to carry over into wisdom. That's the thing, because that's the thing you need in wisdom. If you've got mindfulness there, there'll hardly be any need to practice. It's the mindfulness we lack. There's mindfulness that holds the mind from jumping about. On the other hand, if you've got the mindfulness there, the samadhi is easy anyway. So it works both ways. One thing you can try doing sometimes is to view oneself. To think about, well, at this moment, what do I know? And you can look at the body and you can think, well, there are feelings there, and I know these feelings here. There's sounds coming in. There's maybe smell, maybe taste, whatever it is. And then you can say, well, where does all this knowledge go into? This all goes in somewhere, and then you can sort of search, where is the center of it? And to look in yourself and find it. It's more of a matter of trying to get down to one's present situation, right now. And try to get in right now, I think. Well, the thing is, the external stimulus is a purely mechanical process. And the end result of the mechanical process is the vibration in the culture. And that's still mechanical vibration. That's not sound. Sound is something strange that's within us. We create the sound. Much in the same way as we create light and colour. There's no colour out, no light out there. It's all created. I mean, what there is out there is radiation. Electromagnetic radiation, if science is correct.
Yes, I can see this in my mind, but in the experience I come to, that's
the yes, what you have to do is then to try and make yourself realize this. It's the sort of going over it. I found it very effective to go over the theory. What happens, step by step, and then try to see it in oneself.
Right.
And then it won't, so you just go over it again. What going over it does is to bring confidence in what one's doing. And that confidence then leads on more and more in it. You find in the end that the sensations are all coming here. It's a method, you can try it.
Yes.
People create their future. create what they come to. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's something they don't want to. But where they're creating, they don't want that. In order not to want it, they've got to think about it. And then goes to it's just what creates that realm. Realm of existence. And then creates it and goes to it.
But we are trying to control greed and hate, chinesis, of which Paramatma perhaps is the representative. Isn't Paramatma also something which we should try to deal with?
Yes, but most of the chinesis is concerned with Paramatma, come under the heading of Moha. And this is where the Panyavaddho is. And if one can develop the panya, if one has enough mindfulness to develop the panya directly, so will exist. Most people haven't, so they start doing it and they go off on wild goose chase all over the place. And one's got to do quite a lot of research in oneself as to what exactly bhava means, and what way it's bhava. And I mean, well, this is bhava here. This is a realm of becoming, a realm of existence. There are these different realms of existence, and there are different levels. There's the human realms, there's the deva realms, there's all the rest of them, up and down. But these are really realms of mind. If you look in the Abhidhamma, they've got the different levels of consciousness, and it's just realms of existence, and they're all equations, So the realm one goes to will depend on the level of mind when one, if it's a death at that time. It will depend on the realm of what state of mind is good, it'll be a good realm. If it's bad, it'll be a bad realm. One creates it oneself, the whole thing.
Even in this life, one had some sort of image as to what the rest of one's life is going to be like, even though it doesn't actually turn out that way.
Yeah.
And that seems to me something to get rid of.
I don't know, I don't think one can do it. It's too automatic. The only thing one can do is to just develop the wisdom steadily. And, I mean, this is rather like trying to give up things. Mostly you can't give up them, because you don't know where your attachments are. All one can do is to go on with the practice and develop the wisdom. When the wisdom gets far enough, the understanding comes, there's no need to give up things, they're giving up their mind. You see the truth.
So it's almost giving up, so to speak.
It's not really even the giving up, it's just thinking, oh, I've changed, I no longer want that, I no longer see it like that, it's just something's changed inside. There's not so much a giving up, but the thing no longer is a problem. That's the way the breaking of attachment comes, when it's correct. If you try to give up something, okay, even if you succeed, you grab something else. Insofar as bhava is concerned, probably the best way is to contemplate the nature of this bhava, this existence in which we are. See its nature, see how people are in this world. How much of conceit there is in it. How much of wrong belief there is in this world. Look at any newspaper, you can see it sticking out all over the place. Advertisements, you can see it in those too. And seeing that, and so one gets a sort of more or less a disgust to it, and I think, oh, I don't want to come back to this lot again. one of the troubles is that we don't see what our situation is and how strong those kilesas are. They're very strong. And they attach us to the situation so strongly. One can see one's making karma the whole time. I can't just stop making it like that.
Mm-hmm.
No way.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing one can do is to try to make sure that it's good karma, not
mm-hmm.
bad.
Mm-hmm.
To avoid the bad karma, much as one can. Can't cut it off. The thing to see is that the karma tends to repeat itself. If one has anger coming up, what is the anger? What's it for? When the chickens make a noise, taking it for instance, anyway, it's not the only one, then there's a feeling of unpleasant feeling inside. That feeling is a result of past karma. When that feeling comes up, one doesn't like it. So there's a wanting to stop that feeling. So up comes, I don't like.
Mm.
But the I don't like, the thinking about that is new karma.
There was a monk meditating, and a banded crate, which is a very poisonous snake, went across his lap.
Yeah.
And as he learnt a lot of Dharma in that experience.
Yes. I can't remember who that was now. I was told about this by somebody. He wasn't here, I think. He was told us elsewhere. He was meditating in the forest, cutting a rock, and the snake came straight across and saw the banded crate in the moonlight.
Mm-hmm.
And he just kept very still. He went across and did it.
Ajaan said that animals usually have no yin-yang, that means eyesight, yin-yang. Because if you stand still, keep still, they never know.
No, it's nothing. No, they've got Winyan, but they can't distinguish things unless they're moving.
Oh, yes.
The thing is, many animals are like that. If you notice, you can notice if a frog, for instance, when the frog sees you, it goes dead still because it thinks you can't see it. Many animals are like that. You find that they go still. And the tiger also can't see unless they're moving in the jungle. Yeah.
Mm.
They build up a little platform there if they want to shoot a tiger. They have to build a platform up like this, and they wait. If it's killed a buffalo, they wait for it there. And when it comes, they have to remain dead still. Until it feels confident and it starts eating. And while they remain dead still, although that platform's all up and they're in full view, you can't see them. The odd dogs, most dogs are afraid of tigers. Even if just smell the smell of them, dead tiger. This shows that something deep in them from the past.
Yeah.
Something called
kind of fear, this anxiety. Because my experience is that it gets in the way of my samadhi rather than bringing me to the point, more to the point.
Fear would do that because fear is kilesa.
But what about the fear of the tiger?
That's kilesa as well.
But that's bringing them more in, they use it to get into samadhi.
This is with some people only.
Yeah.
The thing is, if they're afraid enough, the kilesas give way. And they probably have trained enough so that it works in this way.
Yeah.
But mostly it's the kilesas and just bring up fear like that, and the person can't do anything, they just go petrified.
Yeah. I was going to actually ask you this today, but if there's something you can investigate that sort of increases or shifts the security from the body or the idea of a self.
No need to worry about the security there, but the thing is that you've been practicing for calm like that, then you turn to investigation. It could bring up an anxiety.
Yeah.
Because you're in a position where the chitta is very open. And whatever you find out will go into it. And the kilesas could be quite anxious about what you might find out. Now, the thing is, though, that you shouldn't go investigating at the moment until you've got much more control of samadhi.
Yeah.
To do investigation like that when the samadhi is not yet developed enough will probably lead to...
Because you were saying it's nice to do a little at the end. And I have done the same type of investigation, but not when I was so deep.
Well, if you go deep like that, the best thing is to try and keep going. Deep as well.
Okay. But is there any sort of thing that you can... I mean, my sense is what I need to develop is the sense of... It's like trust in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, like that there's another place to depend on, so that as I sort of pull apart this self, I can...
That's even sadhana, faith.
Yeah.
Very valuable.
So that knower part of me or something else.
It is one of the troubles with Varang, is that often they've turned away from Christianity, and they throw out the baby with the bathwater, as you say. Faith is necessary. And after all, we have to have faith in just normal things. We have to have faith the sun will come up in the morning. We don't know that it will. We've got a faith in that. And we have to have faith in all sorts of things. Because of that, sadhā is very, very necessary. One needs to develop trust in the Dhamma, particularly, in the teaching of Buddha. If one can, one of the ways of doing that is to learn about it. And if you learn about it, you see the truth of it.
Yeah.
That truth tends to help with it. Seeing the truth. And that is an important way of developing it. And the supporting of faith with wisdom is very important too. Faith on its own is dangerous. Some people have a lot of faith, no wisdom.
Yeah.
And the trouble is, when you have faith and no wisdom, a person can easily go astray, because that faith can just hook onto anything. There's nothing to control it. And I mean, like this sect in Japan now with gas. There are lots of people that have faith in the leader of that sect. So it's a crazy thing. I mean, these people are just hooked onto that man, and Lord knows what they're getting into. It's an awful mess, anyway, somewhere or another. And this is a way of faith, but it's not supported by wisdom. Also, wisdom, then, if it is going in the right direction, wisdom will help it along. Because the more you see, the more things drop into place, the more reason one has to have confidence. One does need faith. One needs to overcome the anxiety. Sometimes one can build it up in the sense that if you do the practice and you come to a point, and at that point fear comes up, or uncertainty, or something comes up that way, and practice breaks. Then you come back to that again. Bit by bit you become confident by doing it several times. And until one can go beyond that point.
Yeah.
And to face it. Mm-hmm. If you do find fear coming up, it is important. It's a very important thing, because it's kilesa and it can be an awful hindrance. And it can even be dangerous. Fear is the danger, nothing else. Not the thing you're afraid of. And the thing to do then is to turn and investigate this fear. What is this fear? What is nature? Where is it located? Why? In what way does it manifest? For example, fear comes up in the practice. And you immediately look around and you're looking for something that the fear comes from. Is there something external?
Mm-hmm.
A ghost or a tiger or something like that. And it isn't that nature at all. What's happening is that the practice itself is producing changes internally.
Mm.
And one of those changes gives rise to fear, the feeling of fear.
Mm.
When the feeling of fear comes up, our automatic reaction is something must have frightened me.
Mm.
But that's not what's happened at all.
Mm.
It's almost a sort of chemical reaction that's taking place, and the fear is the result of that. But it isn't the same thing as when you see a tiger and then you're afraid.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that at all. It's come the other way around.
You're afraid then you create something.
Yeah.
Something else to come. What about a fear of pain? When you're sitting for so long, the severe pain coming up, the fear too.
Yeah, what happens there, of course, is that one brings on the fear oneself, because one thinks about the pain and the unpleasantness of the pain, and then one builds up the dislike of it. And chelate is very easy to get involved in that. Certain aversion for it comes up. It's important to face it. One thing one must never do is run from it. One must never run from it. Yeah. It's far better to come right out of the practice than to go into a panic. The way is that if one feels that you can't hold it, or you can't cope with it, to pull away from the practice, pull out completely. It's far better than getting caught in something you can't face.
Mm. Wouldn't pulling out of the practice be a way of running away from it?
No, it's not running away from fear there, because when you run away from it, you get into a panic.
Mm.
And if you're avoiding that panic.
So if you see fear approaching.
Yeah. Right. The thing is, by coming out of the practice, you can then get control of yourself, and then you can review the situation. And you can see what happened, and you can see how the fear was the trouble, and that in fact what happened there was not really harmful to oneself, it's just that one was afraid.
Mm.
And can resolve next time then to face up to it. Another thing that Sanatana teaches, which is important for a practice is concerned, when you're going to samadhi and you come to the end of it and you decide to come out, and you come out gently, gradually, because if you come out too quickly it can be a shock to the chitta, and it can make the chitta afraid to get into samadhi. It can act as quite a hindrance. And then you let it just come out gently. Sometimes one doesn't feel that one's particularly deep in practice, but in fact one is much deeper than one realizes. And if you come out suddenly, it's quite a shock, quite a change. Only then do you realize that you are much deeper than you thought. So generally then you come out gradually. Talking about time, past, future, and present. He said about the present, how the present is going past very quickly, going by very quickly. I thought, well, that's a good answer, isn't it? The present doesn't change. And there's no change in the present. The present is just the present, and that's all. In the present, if one can come to that, is a personal thing. The change is taking place externally. The change takes place in events externally, things rising, dying away, and so on. But these are more or less of illusion. Whereas the present doesn't change.
It's very, very interesting to see everything is changing all the time, even inside myself. Even a single cell change.
Yes, all these things are changing. Mm. Everything around about is changing. Mm. But the present is where the chip is.
Mm-hmm.
And nothing doesn't change. And then the world doesn't really know the present.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, when one talks about the world, what does one mean? One means the type of mind which one has in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Which is the mind which is fairly scattered, something about going to this, going to that, not sticking on anything for any length of time. This is in a state of half sleep, really. It's a dreamlike state, really, all the time. And in that state, the illusion is almost complete. It's all right, as long as one doesn't get upset by it.
Mm.
The thing is that we have so much moha, so much delusion in us. We're tied down by this delusion to the world view and the usual ideas in the world, the way things are seen in the world, the accepted conventions. And when we're tied down by that, this is the thing that brings us back to birth all the time.
Mm.
Just these things, the sort of conventions that we're used to, the sort of things that we commonly do, the habits that we're used to doing all the time. These are the things that bring us back all the time. And the breaking up of that is important. One can't do it too quickly. Like everything in nature, the more quickly something changes, the more violent it is. And to change that very quickly requires a great deal of strength and power.
Mm.
Mm. A man came to me today and asked me about meditation practice, and he said that he got a lot of anger coming. And he was doing a lot of investigation, so I told him to stop doing investigation and get some calm. Because he was sort of, when the anger came up, he'd start investigating. Of course, it made the matter worse. I told him to do a good hold. He was doing anapana, but anapana is too subtle. Yeah. And requires something that you can do a grass polar. The thing is, in the West, people who haven't met while they, some people think that they're metta broadcasting stations, I think. So there's a metta flowing out into everybody like that. And mostly this is just conceit. I don't conceit. The thing is, I've got to have the metta there first.
Why didn't the Buddha talk about the Brahma vihara?
To develop fundamentally the attitude of metta, karuna, mudita, upekkha, within oneself, within one's own heart.
Mm.
and the method of doing it is to overcome the opposite, such as hatred in the heart.
Yeah.
And you do that by considering people, because usually they're the hatred to other people. So one takes, first of all, a person you don't, you either like or you're neutral to, something like that. You develop the attitude of metta of that person. Then you go on to somebody who perhaps you don't like quite so much, and so on, until you can find metta of them all. And this develops, the important thing though is not so much the metta goes out to them, to developing yourself. That's what's needed.
He also said or gave a recommendation for spreading metta, actually. Spreading up and down, right and left and front and behind.
But this is in the first instance the developing of metta in oneself. Later, if metta is developed, then it has its effect externally. The only thing is one needs to be a bit careful because it attracts people. Like if you do anapana, when you get calm inside, that calm will be a satisfaction. And then if you think of the world is a satisfactory place. Good satisfactory in yourself.
So the heart opens.
Yeah, heart opens.
It relaxes.
It's automatic in that heart. No need to specifically practice it.
But it can go vice versa. Because I can do, sometimes when I see by then, I contract it and I do a few minutes of metta, it opens up and then I can go into calm.
Yes.
So I think it works both
ways. If you find it works like that, all right, use it. But it's not generally taught in Kamatana. Because other methods of practice are taught more than that now. But I mean, there are instances like Kamatana where it's obviously very important.
In the suttas, the metta, the samavihara has always come after samadhi.
Yes.
And would this be why Kamatan doesn't stress the specific practice of it? But because he's expecting people to develop samadhi first?
I'm not sure, Kamatan. It may be that. Or it may be that he didn't use it. He used other methods. They talk more what he's done. I'm not sure, but he teaches that people should have metta as a faculty in themselves, and they say if they haven't, they should do something about it. It's just more of a sort of thing.
In that sense, it's getting rid of the opposite, like
the
ill will.
But the direct practice of metta isn't always the best way to get rid of it. Sometimes it is. Not always, anyway.
But I experience sometimes when there's some anxiety coming, and I can raise at the same time metta.
Yeah.
Anxiety disappears.
Yeah, yes, this is where one has the metta. I think this is what Tanachan means, that sort of thing, where the metta is there. You can bring it up, but you don't do it with a specific question. Then finally, one goes to Upekha, which is realization that everybody has their own karma. And having their own karma. One can't really alter other people's karma. And because of that, it then goes to complete to a level of state.
So that's really the answer of this discussion. Is, you know, we can develop metta and it's good for us, but how much we actually affect the other people is another question.
It has an effect on people, and people in that environment react quite positively to it. Because that's a good thing. But the only thing is that if one wants to practice on his own, it can be different. So, you have to be careful.
Yes, sir. Tanajan used to say, Tanajan Juan used to say that metta, karuna, mudita should be blended with upekkha.
Yeah.
So that you know that when we reach to Udekhad would not be just like a dead wood. It must be soft and nice.
Yeah. Also, of course, it's quite easy. Udekhad, if one doesn't have the first three, can easily turn into a rather hard attitude.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't care about other people.
Yeah.
That's that sort of it. And that's not the attitude at all. That's wrong. It's necessary to have the other practice of the Dhamma in the heart. I mean, there's all sorts of things in Dhamma, in the Dhamma teaching of the Buddha, where quite a bit of a bag of tools. Sometimes you have to pull out this one, sometimes another one. It's like that all the time. You have to have the right tools for the right job.
Mm-hmm.